I've told you before to be careful where you put your legs.
I was only trying to be helpful.
I can help myself. Hello? They never make these cars big enough, do they? Well, you all settled in? Right, we can begin. My name is...
Alfie.
I suppose you think you're going to see the bleeding titles now. Well, you're not, so you can all relax.
Alfie!
Here. What time did your old man say he'd be waiting for you at the station?
Oh, never mind about him.
That's just who I am going to mind. Never spoil a good thing. That's a thing you women can't get into your heads. Come on now, enough's as good as a feast.
Oh, you soon changed your tune.
Well, that horn put me off. I hate a noise at a time like that. Hey, mate.
You don't forget your napkin.
I won't.
Do you know what I thought the first time I saw you put your handkerchief over your shoulder?
What?
Thought you were going to take out your fiddle and play it.
Well, I come from a musical family, don't I? A married woman, see? They're every one of them in need of a good laugh. You don't never strike their husbands. I always say, make a married woman laugh and you're halfway there with her. Of course, it don't work with a single bird. Start you off on the wrong foot. You get one of them laughing, you won't get nothing else.
And it's the real take two. Here we go.
Good evening. Take two on take two.
Good evening, one and all. This is Public Radio KCBX, broadcasting from San Luis Obispo. And it's time to go to the movies. Across the aisle from me in the posh projection room of the KCBX studios, it's we just returned from the pub talking about Michael Caine. It's Bob Whiteford.
And across the aisle from me, the incomparable, the czar of film on the Central Coast, Gentleman Jim Dee. And Jim, we've got a winner here tonight.
Our opening was from the classic Michael Caine film, Alfie, and that was one of the films that put him on the map, but what was it, well over 30 years ago?
1966. Wow.
Amazing.
Holy smokes. I can't believe it's been that long.
And the reason we're talking about Michael Caine on tonight's program is slowly getting released across the country right now is his latest film, called The Quiet American. I actually want to thank our listener from Santa Barbara, Catherine Covenay, for some interesting reading on The Quiet American. But I will guarantee or hope for an Oscar nomination for Michael Caine for The Quiet American. I saw it last September at the Toronto Film Festival. And if he doesn't get nominated, I'll A, petition the Academy, and B, I will nominate him myself. He'll get, you know, the sixth Academy Award nomination will come from me, for Michael Caine, for The Quiet American.
That is why, ladies and gentlemen, Jim Dee is the czar of film on the Central Coast. If he doesn't like the nominations, he will go out and make his own. I second that statement. Caine is absolutely incredible in this film, and folks, it will be coming to a theater near you. Check it out. Michael Caine in a powerful performance.
Now, before we begin tonight's program focusing on the great Michael Caine, I do want to make mention of some dates you should put on your calendar. The Santa Barbara International Film Festival will begin on February the 28th and run through March the 9th. This year's Santa Barbara International Film Festival will screen over 100 films and from over 30 countries. There'll be 11 U.S. premieres, lots more. So mark your calendars, the Santa Barbara International Film Festival, February the 28th through March the 9th.
Well, you know, now we're getting back to the Michael Caine story. Born Morris Micklewhite in London in 1933, from probably pretty humble beginnings, a Cockney, basically. As a young man, he entered the Army, National Service, and served in Korea, where I guess he saw some action in the very early 1950s. Once he was discharged from the Army, he returned to London looking for something, anything to do, and he found a job as a stage manager, and that's how he got involved in acting. I guess as a stage manager in those days, he would occasionally step out and do bit parts when they needed someone or someone didn't show up, and he found he kind of liked it. So over the course of time, he started getting more involved in theater and cinema. In fact, I think 1956 was his first film role, a movie appropriately called Hill in Korea. I believe it was also Robert Shaw's first film. And, you know, that's, I guess, kind of the generation of British actors that Caine is a part of. The Terence Stamp, Albert Finney, Robert Shaw, kind of David Hemmings school of British actors. Lawrence Harvey, Richard Todd, Richard Harris, they kind of come to mind as well.
It's interesting you mention Peter O'Toole, I believe. I think he was an understudy for with Peter O'Toole. He was also a roommate with
Terence Stamp for many years.
Yes.
And which is kind of interesting. I guess at one time in the early 60s, he was homeless, and the great movie music maestro John Barry, who did the music to the James Bond films, amongst many others, including Caine's groundbreaking role in 1964's Zulu, but we'll get to that later. Apparently he crashed at his pad for a while too. So Caine was definitely not only an actor on the rise in the early 60s, but he was also a part of swinging London as well.
Well, with their opening clip from Alfie, when I was looking at that today, Bob, I mean, it holds up. It of course has that sort of dated 60s, 70s feel about it, but it was pretty, it holds up, and it didn't cop out near the end. And well, basically Alfie is about the professional gigolo or the professional philanderer who really zeroes in on those married women and knows how to have some fun with them.
How to give him a good time. And oddly enough, he meets his Waterloo with Shirley Winters of all people.
Shelley Winters.
Oh, did I say Shirley? Oh,
that's okay.
it's the medication.
Yeah, Bob has a little cold. It wasn't that he was at the pub or anything. So yeah, Alfie really brought him to the forefront. And, and you know, if you've seen Michael Caine recently, maybe in the Cider House Rules or when you see him in Quiet American, and then I was looking at him today in Alfie, I mean, he's, what, late 20s, early 30s. He's very young. And also, as we were saying, Bob, he comes from working class stock, but I look at him as sort of a blue-collar working class actor. He works, and he's in classics, and he's in some real junk. He's in lots of television productions. He made a lot of guest appearances on television shows in the 60s, which was interesting.
Laughing, the Don Rickles show.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
he's
right.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, probably my favorite Michael Caine story is when he won the Academy Award for his role as Elliot in Woody Allen's Hannah and Her Sisters. And, of course, he wasn't there to receive the award because I think he was down in the Bahamas filming Jaws the Revenge, which was a real piece of junk. And Jim, you've got a great quote from that.
Well, tell the whole story and I'll give you the quote.
Well, the funny, back it up. It's just great because he's not there to win the award. Where is he? He's sunning on the beach in the Bahamas, and the reporters are chasing after him going, well, why weren't you there? He goes, why should I be there? It's cold there. It's beautiful here. I'm making $10 million just to sit on this beach. Look, my family's having a nice vacation. This is lovely. Of course I'm not going to be there. And it just, it really showed his Cockney roots, his work ethic. He's already moved on from a great role to, you know, a questionable role, but he's giving it his all. And more importantly, he's having a lot of fun doing it.
He likes to work, but he also likes the benefits of the work, whether it's the classic script or it's Jaws, The Revenge. Here's the quote from Michael Caine. Quote, I have never seen it regarding Jaws, The Revenge, but by all accounts, it is terrible. However, I have seen the house that it built, and it is terrific.
That's Caine in a nutshell, and that's why we love him so.
Yeah. You know, in looking at a lot of the films that we're going to play some sound bites for you tonight on the program, so many different roles, and, you know, and when we pick Michael Caine because of this current role that he has, but what a lengthy career. And as we go from Alfie, the very self-assured gigolo, to a hitman in Get Carter, which I'm not sure what the date of that one was.
1971.
I was watching bits of Get Carter, and boy, this is a powerful film. I was thinking Martin Scorsese could have directed this. It was tough. It was violent. It was very sexy. There was nudity, and I was thinking, wow, this movie's from early 70s, and didn't pull any punches.
Absolutely not. In fact, it's directed by a very underrated filmmaker, Mike Hodges, who Caine returned a year later to do a film called Pulp, which probably nobody saw. I think that was the last film Lisbeth Scott was in, but I don't want to get off the trail here. Get Carter, the 1971 version. Michael Caine is ruthless.
Ruthless.
I mean, he's a killing machine, and I mean, he has some conscience, but basically he's just a killer unleashed on the mob. And he'll kill police, anybody who gets in his way. And don't confuse it with the really ghastly Sylvester Stallone remake of a couple of years, which Caine had a cameo in as
That's
well.
That's right.
They paid him a few bob for that, I'm sure.
but Bob, when I was watching Get Carter today, for instance, it felt like a real inversion of James Bond, sort of, where, as you said, Michael Caine is this ruthless killer, but he's the leading man. He's the handsome leading man, but don't mess with this guy. And, you know, I mean, they say James Bond has a license to kill. I mean, this guy obviously has a license to kill, and he kills people throughout the film.
And there's no sentimentality to him. He's really brutal and ruthless in how he you know, he prosecutes his killings. He just, it kind of reminded me of another one of his contemporaries that I didn't mention, which is Sean Connery, especially the way Connery dispatched people in Dr. No with no second thought about it. But in this one in particular, the violence for 32 years ago now is pretty intense.
Yeah.
And it's a real gritty film. I mean, it's shot in Newcastle, England. It's not pretty. There's nothing about it that's, you know, that lovely. I mean, there's nothing sentimental. It's raw. It's a great film. And I think we even have a clip from it.
Yeah, this is from Get Carter. This is when Michael Caine, who is the hitman, gets sort of the assignment that he's going to go on that's captured with the film.
We don't want you to go up the north, Jack.
No.
You work for us, Jack. You know we're connected with the Newcastle mob. I'd hate you to screw it up. What's that, a python? What are you going for?
To find out what happened.
Look, your brother's dead and gone. They're hard nuts up there, Jack. They won't take kindly to someone from London poking his nose in.
Too bad.
Remember, they're killers, just like you. The police seem satisfied.
Since when was that good enough?
Think again, Jack.
I will.
That's Michael Caine from Get Carter, a tough as nails film from 1971, and highly recommended if you're in that sort of Martin Scorsese Goodfellas kind of mood, and really predating those films by 15 years or so.
It's amazing. The British have always made very good gangster films. Stanley Baker comes to mind from the late 50s, early 60s, films like The Criminal and Concrete Jungle. And you know, it's interesting, Michael Caine got his start in a Stanley Baker-produced film called Zulu, which that's another part of the Caine mystique, was the war film, such movies as Battle of Britain, Too Late the Hero, Robert Aldrich's excellent film from 1970 that co-starred Cliff Robertson. A film that was not seen and has only been rediscovered years later on late-night television and video. It's an anti-war classic. He also did a bizarre film called Play Dirty, where he led a group of British commandos that included two Arab homosexuals. It was a very bizarre film. But that shows the Caine stamp.
Mm-hmm.
Great films, very odd, and in some cases, very bad films.
But he's always comfortable in every role
always,
he takes on.
Absolutely. Always brings something special to the table. Yeah. Always.
And you know, Bob, we've been misquoting. It is Sir Michael Caine. He was knighted June 17th, 2000 for his contribution to the performing arts. So
you stand corrected.
Apologies to Michael. It's Sir Michael Caine.
Sir Maurice Micklewhite.
Well, you know, as we move on looking at this amazing career of Michael Caine, you know, later on, I think in the early 90s, he put out a book and a video about acting in film. I mean, what better source than this amazing, hardworking actor? A book, Bob has a copy of the book right here, but to see the video, to get that expertise on acting in film is priceless. And to prove that this guy early on had his acting chops, we move to a great film called Sleuth. It's an amazing film, and it's Michael Caine going head-to-head, toe-to-toe with Sir Laurence Olivier.
And I think we got a clip from it.
Give you a little build-up on this Sleuth clip, Michael Caine has apparently been sleeping with Laurence Olivier's wife. But Laurence Olivier wants to get rid of his wife, so he says, and they want to make this fake burglary, and there's a setup going on right here. Here are Michael
Caine. It's a
real
battle of wits.
It's a battle of wits. Well said. It's Michael Caine and Sir Laurence Olivier from Sleuth.
There's an open season all year round for some creatures, seducers and wife stealers, for example.
Now, that's a bad Italian joke.
You should know it's your country of origin, is it not?
No, actually, I'm English. I was born here, in England.
Where are you now? Actually, what in dear old cradle of the parliamentary system, who screws my wife merits a large pink gin, England?
Sense of humour, fair play, England, I mean.
Oh, don't you believe it. That's the way a foreigner talks. What he really thinks in private is filthy, wet country, ugly, red, cold men who don't know how to treat their pale, pink, cool women.
Well, what brought all this on, then? What are you doing with that gun?
Pretty obviously pointing it at you.
I can see that, but why?
Because I'm a gonna killer you.
You are gonna killer me? Jesus! Here we go again with another one of your games.
Another one? No. It's the same one. We've been playing it all the evening. It's called You're Going to Die and No One Will Suspect Murder.
Laurence Olivier, Michael Caine from Sleuth. If you want the ultimate cat and mouse game, check out this movie. And again, going back to those acting skills, this is the film to really check out these two going going to it on screen.
Just listening to the clip, it's just, this is just a marvelous bit. I mean, the pair of them just going toe-to-toe, and we know that Sir Laurence Olivier, one of the greatest actors of all time, and here's now Sir Michael Caine going toe-to-toe with him, exchanging barbs, more than holding his own.
Mm-hmm. It's a great film. I would say that that's one of my, well, we'll get to the man who would be king, but to really get the feel for Michael Caine's great talent, check out Sleuth.
You know, I'm thinking, you know, over the years, yeah, I guess Man Who Would Be King, that kind of came a few years afterwards, 1975 or so. I mean, and sandwiched in between, there's, you know, some films like X, Y, and Z with Elizabeth Taylor. Ooh, boy, that was a pretty bad one. And there was some other pretty ghastly ones. But, you know, I want to mention, too, very quickly, the Harry Palmer series, spy films from the 60s. Mm-hmm. I know we're a little all over the place, folks, but Michael Caine, there's a massive body of work, and his spy films were excellent. Funeral in Berlin, The Ypcris File, mm-hmm. and Ken Russell's kind of nutty Harry Palmer film, The Billion Dollar Brain with Carl Malden. Highly recommended for auteurs of the spy film. I'd also recommend the one he did also with Laurence Olivier from 1983 called The Jigsaw Man, where he plays Philip Kimberley, which is actually a take on the famous British turncoat spy Kim Philby. A wonderful little movie. The spy film Fourth Protocol comes to mind.
Oh, yeah.
With Pierce Brosnan. Probably the last film, Cold War spy thriller before the end of the Cold War. Caine really was right at home in the spy film.
And, well, in a way, his newest film, The Quiet American, gets back into that turf since it takes place in Vietnam around the early 50s or so. And, folks, I'm going to keep coming back to that, but if you do have a chance to see Michael Caine's newest film, which is slowly opening across the country right now, The Quiet American, go out of your way to see it. And I do predict that Oscar nomination for Best Actor.
And then we've got comedy. And, yeah. You know, I think he won his first Academy Award for a comedy, if I'm not mistaken. Woody Allen's...
Hannah and Her Sisters.
Oh, yeah. We've got to talk about that.
Yeah. Well, the story you just told, he wasn't at the Oscars, too busy doing Jaws the Revenge. But what's very interesting is we get to Hannah and Her Sisters, Michael Caine, very vulnerable in this role, where he's very self-assured in Alfie, where he's the ultimate hitman in Get Carter, where he sort of goes back and forth in Sleuth. But in Hannah and Her Sisters, here's a guy who you always see together, but on screen he pretty much falls apart. He's married to Mia Farrow, and he falls in love with Mia Farrow's sister, that's played by Barbara Hershey. And what a role. I mean, we have a great clip from Hannah and Her Sisters right now, and if you can hear the quiet desperation, you know what's going on with Michael Caine. Also, like in Alfie, you hear his thoughts. So there are times where he sort of, in Alfie, Michael Caine turns to the camera and, you know, chats about, you know, how it is to go to bed with this certain married woman and so on and so forth, you know, the details. And in Hannah and Her Sisters, he turns to the camera or you hear his thoughts. Here's Michael Caine and Mia Farrow from Hannah and Her Sisters.
Are you in a bad mood?
I don't know. I'm just dancing.
Yes, I know. The last few weeks you haven't been yourself. And tonight at dinner, you were kind of curt with me.
Was I?
Yes, you were. And when I brought up the idea of having a baby, you sort of jumped down my throat.
Well, I don't think it's a very good idea.
Why not?
Because it's the last thing in the world we need right now.
Why do you say that? Is there something wrong?
I don't know.
Well, tell me, should I be worried?
Well, you got four children.
I want one with you.
Well, I think we should wait till things settle.
So what's that mean? We've been married 4 years. How settled can things get?
You know, you have some very set plans on how your life should be structured. A house, kids, certain school, a home in Connecticut. It's all very preconceived.
Yeah, Yeah, but I thought you needed that. When we met, you said your life was chaos.
I know, but there's got to be some give and take. Oh, listen, I don't know what the hell I'm talking about.
Are you angry with me?
No.
Do you feel, are you disenchanted with our marriage?
I didn't say that.
Are you in love with someone else?
My God, what is this? The Gestapo? No.
Well, what are you not telling me?
What kind of interrogation? Supposing I said yes, I am disenchanted. I am in love with someone else.
Are you?
No. But you keep asking these awful questions. My God, it's like you want me to say yes.
What are you talking about? Of course not. I'd be destroyed.
For Christ's sake, stop torturing her. Tell her you want out and get it over with. You're in love with her sister. You didn't do it on purpose. Be honest. It's always the best way.
Look, can I help you? If you're suffering over something, will you share it with me?
Bella, you know how much I love you. I ought to have my head examined. I don't deserve you.
Boy, the great thing for Michael Caine in this film is the fact that you get the exterior, the person who is, you know, torn between what, you know, falling in love with your wife's sister, and you get that internal dialogue. I mean, and he fleshes it out so amazingly.
Gotta hand it to Woody Allen. Terrific direction and excellent writing, and boy, Caine really delivered the goods on this one. I mean, in a sense, Woody Allen transformed Michael Caine into an English version of himself, mm-hmm. which I thought was kind of interesting. Something that he repeated years later with Kenneth Branagh, I think, in Celebrity, turned him into Woody Allen.
Oh, yeah.
To a little less successful degree, but this was a fascinating film, and probably Woody Allen, arguably his last truly great film, and Michael Caine had a lot to do with that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of the other Oscar nominations, like we said, for Hannah and Her Sisters, he won the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor. He was also nominated for Alfie, for Sleuth, and Educating Rita in 1983. And but then right after that, of course, well, not before that, or around there, like you're saying, Blame It on Rio, one of the great trash ones. And let's not forget Michael Caine in Beyond the Poseidon Adventure.
Let's not forget that. I mean, most people did, but you and I didn't, Jim. And we can't let Sir Michael Caine escape without discussing Beyond the Poseidon Adventure. Well, not only should he be ashamed, but I mean, Sally Field should be ashamed. 20th Century Fox should be ashamed for trying to do it. Telly Savalas, God bless him. He was, I mean, it was an all-star cast in that film. Boy, what talk about the end of the disaster film. Pooh, that was a ghastly, ghastly film, and I loved it.
Me too. You're listening to the movie program on Public Radio, KCBX, San Luis Obispo, and Santa Barbara counties. My name is Jim Dee. I'm here with Bob Whiteford. We're talking about Michael Caine because of his new great film called The Quiet American. We're going to head over to the concession stand, refill our drinks and our popcorn, and we'll be right back. Glad you're there. Of course, we'll open up the phone lines in a little bit. We've got some more great sound bites for you from one of my all-time greatest films. I would say it's in my top five that stars Michael Caine. We'll get to those in just a moment. But again, looking over the huge body of work, and we just mentioned, maybe not too correctly, the idea of comedy. Hannah and Her Sisters, not so much really a comedy for Michael Caine. But, you know, he was in, what, the most recent Austin Powers film. I guess he's Austin Powers' father. He was also teamed up with Steve Martin in Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, pretty much playing the straight man to Steve Martin's character and doing an incredible job. And he can do it all. It's
Let's not forget, going back a few years, The Italian Job with Noel Coward and Benny Hill and a bunch of other people. Yeah, in retrospect, I would have to say, yeah, I may have put my foot in my mouth by calling it a comedy. I mean, it had comedic elements, but there certainly was some very heavy subtext to that film.
I could even say that about Alfie. I mean, it's his cool, calm, and collected details of all these women that he's sleeping with, and by golly, they're all married. But it's very, you know, literate, comedic, underplayed, and he's addressing the camera throughout Alfie. So, good old Michael Caine. Here's another quote of Michael Caine. I am in so many movies that are on TV at 2 a.m. that people think I am dead.
They obviously just saw The Swarm for the 18th time.
Well, as we continue to talk about Michael Caine, I guess we'll come to what I consider my pièce de résistance for Michael Caine. It's also one of my all-time favorite movies. John Huston's The Man Who Would Be King.
And I think to set the stage for this particular clip we're going to play, I just was reading Caine's book, and the script for Man Who Would Be King was very thorough and concise. There was only one scene where they did some ad-libbing, and this particular scene was it. This is where Michael Caine and Sean Connery go to... I guess some British official who, after they've been accused of blackmailing someone, and the way they play the scene, it's pure Michael Caine and Sean Connery following his lead. And it's a brilliant piece of improvisation that Huston loved and kept it in the film.
Here we go. Here's Michael Caine, Sean Connery from The Man Who Would Be King.
Jimmy, what part of the law?
You men are not under arrest, thanks to Mr. Kipling here, who happens to be a genuine correspondent for the Northern Star. But both of you richly deserve to be in jail. I have your records before me. There's everything in them, from smuggling to swindling to receiving stolen goods to barefaced blackmail.
Sir, I resent the accusation of blackmail. It is blackmail to obtain money by threats of publishing information in a newspaper. But what blackmail is there in accepting a small retainer for keeping it out of a newspaper?
And how did you propose to keep it out?
By telling the editor what I know about his sister and a certain government official in these parts.
Let him put that in his paper if he has need of news.
You know, what's great about that clip, Bob, is... You know, these guys want to be kings, and they're also politicians. You know, they know how to put one over on this guy, and the fact they, you know, I mean, they're accused of blackmail, and they say, well, we're not
we
didn't do that, but right now we're going to blackmail you, you know? That's the way these guys work.
Brilliant. And it just, you could just imagine Caine's sneering smile going out through the audio out there. It's like, I mean, his face, it's just, he's smirking, he's laughing. Oh, he's beautiful. I love Michael Caine. He's the greatest.
You know, one thing I was going to say about The Man Who Would Be King, of course, John Huston directed, and one of my all-time favorite directors, but what a great companion piece, and you can... Well, a great double feature, perhaps, with Treasure of Sierra Madre.
Absolutely.
A story of lusty men on a lusty adventure. You know, they're after gold in Treasure of Sierra Madre. In this one, they're after being kings and, you know, becoming rich as well, of course. That's the bottom line. But it's that the human trait of what happens when you become too rich. Or in the case of The Man Who Would Be King, I don't want to give it away, but... When you may think that you're a god and you take it seriously,
you're in serious trouble.
You're in serious trouble.
You know, it's an interesting factoid about The Man Who Would Be King, Jim. Originally, it was supposed to be made 20 years before, in 1955, starring Humphrey Bogart and Clark Gable.
Wow, I didn't know that.
And what happened was that was right around the time Bogart got ill, so that kind of pulled the plug on it. But that was the original casting of the film, and they were going to do it in the 50s. One would ponder about the possibilities of Bogart-Gable teaming, especially at that point in their careers, what that film would have been, especially under the hand of John Huston. I could only imagine. But what we do have with Michael Caine and Sean Connery is nothing short of an absolute classic.
And, you know, it was one of those things where even now I would love to see Sean Connery and Michael Caine together in a film. This was the only one, and like perhaps Newman and Redford, who only teamed up twice, I mean, the ultimate in chemistry. And maybe I should be content with, well, I am content with The Man Who Would Be King. I would love to still see these two guys team up and do something else, because the chemistry is unbelievable. There's what's also great about Sean Connery in this film is he was still James Bond, but boy, he shed the whole secret agent thing amazingly in this film. He's this rough and tumble Danny, and he's going to be a king, and boy, it's a great adventure.
Interestingly enough, I think a few years later, 1977, they were both in Richard Attenborough's epic war film, A Bridge Too Far.
Oh, okay.
But I don't believe they were. It's funny, I don't think they had any scenes together, or they may have had one. I mean, it was a case of one of these, you know, what they used to do with these gigantic, big-budget war movies like The Longest Day and whatnot, kind of episodic, and you have all these stars, all this special effects, a cast of thousands, extras, tanks, planes, guns, bombs. And it's kind of a shame because they're kind of the nexuses of the film. Sean Connery's in Arnhem. Michael Caine is leading the column to rescue him, but they never meet because the column never gets there. Ergo, their characters, I don't think, maybe for a brief moment at the end, come into contact. And it's kind of a non-scene, and it's really kind of a shame because I agree, their chemistry is amazing.
Amazing. I guess they're good friends, you know, in real life, and it's just too bad that maybe they didn't even pursue another film or vehicle to showcase those talents. And, you know, again, I could do a whole show on Man Who Would Be King. You talk about in today's film, you know, what it is to be a man or an adventurer. And it just gets into perhaps this macho-ness to where, you know, how, you know, who you can kick or who you can beat. In this film, it takes on almost mythic proportions. And the fact that there's one scene in The Man Who Would Be King where they get to a point where they can't go any further. They realize they're dead. They can't get past this mountain range or something. And they get to talking, and they essentially get to the point where they're laughing at death. They're just laughing their heads off from the fact that this is as far as we got, this is the end of it, you know, and they're laughing at death. And it's the sound of their laughing that causes the avalanche to make them go forward. I mean, that's the stuff of mythology.
And what I loved about this film was it wasn't just the fact that they, quote unquote, had technology. More than anything else, they had a lot of guile and moxie.
Mm-hmm.
And all too often in films these days, you know, people can, you know, a couple of keystrokes on a computer can take the place of just good old-fashioned guile. And these guys had it in droves, and they had unbelievable charisma. I would have followed these guys to the end of the earth.
Well, let's hear their credo. Here's another clip from The Man Who Would Be King. It's Sean Connery, Michael Caine, telling Rudyard Kipling, who is played by
Christopher Plummer,
who you know, rounds out that trio in this film, just an amazing three in this film, and their aspirations to become kings.
And now, sir, let me introduce you to Brother Peachy Carnahan, which is him, and Brother Daniel Dravot, which is I. The less said about our professions, the better. But we have been most things in our time. We've been all over India. We know her cities, her jungles, her jails, and her passes. And we have decided that she isn't big enough for such as we.
Yes, that's what I understood the commissioner to say.
Therefore, we are going away to another place, where a man isn't crowded and can come into his own. We're not little men, so we're going away to be kings. Kings of Kafiristan.
Oh.
Kafiristan.
We hear they have 32 idols there. So we'll be the 33rd and 34th.
It's a place of warring tribes, which is to say, a land of opportunity for such as we, who know how to train men and lead them into battle.
We'll go there. We'll say to any chief we can find, do you want to vanquish your foes? Of course, you'll say. Go to it. We'll fight for him, make him king, then we'll subvert that king. We'll seize his royal throne and loot the country 4 ways from Sunday.
How's that for a plan?
You're right, Bob. I would follow Peachy and Danny anywhere. These guys are the most adorable scoundrels you would ever see on the screen.
Absolutely.
And the country, after that clip, the country that they're going to become kings of is just above Afghanistan, apparently. And Rudyard Kipling says, you're not even going to make it through Afghanistan, let alone get to where you want to be.
Well, they made it. We know that much. We won't give away much more about it, but they did make it. You know, I was thinking about another film Michael Caine made, Dress to Kill, Brian De Palma.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that. What an odd film that was. What an odd departure for Caine in that particular film, which I have. It's one of my favorite De Palma films. Mm. And again, it's Michael Caine bringing something really special to that because, as you know, he's a person with a split personality, or should I just say a personality disorder, and he's just wonderful in that film. So much better in that like horror thriller film than say Oliver Stone's directorial debut, The Hand, which was a monstrosity, but in the bad sense of the word.
But it very starred Michael Caine. let's open up the phone lines. It's 549-8855 or 1-800-549-8855. We're talking about Michael Caine, about his incredible lengthy career, as well as his new movie, which is directed by Australian director Philip Noyce. It's called The Quiet American. It should be rolling out into theaters slowly, and I will go on record as saying he will get an Oscar nomination for his excellent performance in this film.
And we're here to talk about his great films, and you know what? We'll even talk about his not-so-great films. There's plenty of both. So, folks, give us a call. Let's talk Michael Caine.
It's 549-8855, 1-800-549-8855. Tell us your name and where you're calling from, and good evening. You're on take two. Hi.
Good evening. This is Richard from Paso Robles.
Hi, Richard.
Great show, as always, you guys.
Thank you.
And I don't know if you mentioned it. I didn't hear it. I believe Michael Caine's wife is the young actress who played Roxanne that married Danny up there in the mountains of Kafiristan.
That is absolutely correct.
Yeah, in fact, hanging in there with him.
Yeah.
So all those actors aren't wild philanderers, I guess.
Well, I guess at this point, she put an end to Caine's philandering. I think her name is Shakira.
I believe so.
Something like that. Oh, you're absolutely correct. And what a beautiful woman she is.
Yes.
And one of my all-time favorites, too, you guys. I'm glad you're going into detail on it. It's a tremendous film all the way around. After Danny gets to be king, and Michael Caine calls him on the fact that he was holding on to the tail of the donkey when he got to be snowblind, and yet now he thinks he's king.
Yeah.
And then Connery says, oh, old Jenny done her part. You know, he's still not coming down to earth. What a beautiful film.
Yeah.
Great stuff. But one thing before I go, I know you'll have lots of calls, but Bob, I got to call you on a comment from last week.
Sure.
You downplayed another great Marlon Brando's role as Zucchini in the movie where he's in Okinawa with the U.S. Army.
Oh, Tea House of the August Moon?
You betcha. That is hilarious every time I watch that, you guys. don't sell that one short. He's a great Okinawan.
Okay. We were just having a little fun with him on that one.
Thanks again, you guys.
Thanks, Richard.
Take care now.
Bye-bye. Right.
Good evening. You're on take two.
Hi there. My name's Andy. I'm from Arroyo Grande.
Hi, Andy.
I wonder if you remember a film called The Wrong Box that I think Michael Caine was in with Sophia Loren as well as a supporting actress.
Oh, wait a minute. Tell us where you're from.
Arroyo Grande.
But beyond that, with that accent, I hear an accent.
Oh, I'm from Michael Caine land.
Oh, right.
I grew up in a cinema watching The Ipcress File, and that was almost the finest thing to happen to me in my late teenage years.
Oh, it's great to hear that.
I went out there and I was shooting people on street corners for weeks and weeks after that film.
Wow. Now, we've got all of his films in front of us. The Wrong Box, any idea about the year? Because this list goes on 100 plus.
And probably within a couple of years at The Ipcress File, one way or the other.
I would think around 66 would be my guess.
I've tried to rent it since, because I've also tried to rent The Ipcress File, but I don't know if anybody's actually recorded it. But,
okay, you know, it was available at one time. I think, I don't know, was it Sophia Loren or Shirley MacLaine in that?
I thought it was Sophia Loren, because she was incredibly good-looking, if I remember, because I was also young then, too.
Oh, you know, I think you're right, and it was directed by Brian Forbes, who worked on the Avengers TV series. I haven't seen that film in any way, shape, or form in decades. I don't know what's happened with that.
I thought it was a film of its time. It was a Peter Cook and Dudley Moore comedy, and because they did the original Bedazzled, and I'm not sure if Bedazzled was just before or just after that.
I've got The Wrong Box coming out in 1966. The character that Michael Caine played was Michael Finsbury.
Gosh, and that's one I don't think we've seen.
Well, what happened in that was the story, without giving too much away, is there is a tontine set up, which basically is an inheritance that's inherited by the last survivor of a group of friends. And Peter Cook and Dudley Moore have one relative, and Michael Caine, the sort of innocent young man, has another relative, and someone tries to cover up someone's death, and a box is carried around with a body in it for the entire movie. And, of course, it's rather like the original Bedazzled. It's kind of, you know, a Peter Cook and Dudley Moore laugh-a-minute type movie.
Oh, Bedazzled.
Definitely worth digging up and enjoying.
Those guys were hilarious. You know, I think in retrospect, I think the film he made with Shirley MacLaine was called Gambit. That may have come out the same year. Gosh, that's a great film. I wish it was out there. I'd love to see it.
Well, if I ever come across it, you guys will be the first people I'll tell.
Oh, please do.
Appreciate that.
Okay, well, thanks very much. I enjoyed sharing that with you.
Thank you.
Thanks for the call.
Bye-bye.
Good evening. You're on take two. Hi. Hello.
Is it me?
It's you.
Hi, this is Pete. I was told I was number four.
You're number one now, Pete.
Right on. Hello, guys. Good show.
Thank you.
Just as a oddball comment, when I was in Marrakesh, Morocco, in 76... the word went out to the visiting community that Michael Caine was making a movie, and they're looking for a double to do some of the, you know, fall off a camel or something, who knows what. And so I auditioned for that and almost got it.
Wow.
Wow. Did you
so
put on...
I don't know what movie that was, but it was...
Man Who Would Be
King. Summer of 76 when I was there. So it's just kind of a interesting tidbit.
Boy.
So what came out in 76 or 7 or something like that?
Well,
filmed in a desert.
Not Harry and Walter Go to New York, but...
unlikely.
It could have been Man Who Would Be King. Pete, are you sure it was 76? Because Man Who Would Be King came out in 75.
I was there in 76. And
well, you know, he did make a film called Ashanti, and that's another one of his kind of bad films. It was about white slavers and Arabs. Omar Sharif was in it as well. That came out, I think it did finally come out in 1979, and it was also known as Ashanti, Land of No Mercy. I did have the dubious displeasure of seeing this film at one time. Count your lucky stars, my man, you weren't in it, because it was a stinker.
Oh, I was going to make a killing anyway. Great show. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Pete.
Bye-bye.
See ya.
Thank you.
Good evening. You're on take two. Hello.
Hi, this is Tony from Pismo Beach.
Hey, Tony.
Hey, there was one that I wanted to bring up. I don't know how many people have seen this, but actually Michael Caine was great in A Muppet Christmas Carol.
Was he
Scrooge?
He's playing Scrooge, right?
In Muppet Christmas Carol. Yeah.
That was just a few years ago. I'm trying to look for it on the list here. But I could see him being a great Scrooge.
Probably one of the best Muppet movies. I mean, other than the first one, maybe. But
here it is. It came out in 1992.
Yes.
So, yeah, I mean, I think that he has the elements of being the ultimate Scrooge, and then, of course, what happens to Scrooge after the night of the, you know, the three Christmas ghosts.
Yes.
Great.
All right.
Thanks for the comment.
Thank you.
Take care. Good evening. You're on take two. Hello.
Hi, this is Jan from San Luis Obispo.
Hi, Jan.
Hi. One of my favorite films of all time is Michael Caine in Educating Rita. Did you talk about that film?
I think he did get an Oscar nomination for that, but that was all we mentioned. But yeah, and I'm trying to think of the woman. Why
Julie Waters?
Walters. She's just a spitfire in that film, and she's such a great actress.
It was. I was actually teaching in the community college at that time, and it's about a community college teacher who has a hairdresser as a student. And brings out her ability to write and think, and he was so sensitive, and it was just such a wonderful film. I just wanted to bring it up if you haven't talked about it already, and hear what you guys had to say about it.
Oh, I love the film. I mean, mm-hmm. and it's just, and there was great chemistry there too with Julie Walters and Michael Caine. Just a great pair on screen.
Mm-hmm. I remember the one scene where she's cutting his hair, and he's you know, he's got a bottle in the drawer in his desk, and It's interesting because he's helping her, but what's interesting is she's helping him because he's starting to feel like he's a teacher again. Mm-hmm. He's reached her, and it's a marvelous relationship that you think is going to end up in a romantic entanglement, and it doesn't, and that makes it far more poignant.
Right. And see, this is the thing about him as an actor. He's just got so much depth and sensitivity and... I wish there were more actors like him right now. I mean, so many of them are so superficial. I think he's really a great actor.
I agree.
Yeah, Educating Rita came out in 1983.
No kidding.
Yep. He played Dr. Frank Bryant in it.
Gosh, hard to believe that was 20 years ago.
Just exactly, wasn't it? Well, yeah. I guess that's what I was doing 20 years ago. Thank you for your show. I really appreciate it very much.
Thanks for the call.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Good evening, you're on take two. Hello.
Hey, Richard here.
Hi, Richard.
How you guys doing?
Good.
Not bad.
Anyway, there was a film that Michael made with Christopher Reeves where they had a passionate kiss.
Oh, Death Trap.
The name of it.
Death Trap.
That was Death Trap?
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, the whole movie was going along and it was very mysterious. And when that happened, it just kind of blew my mind. I don't know if it was because of my age or what, but I just wanted to know what movie that was.
Definitely.
Anyway, Man Who Would Be King, Jim, is one of my favorites all time.
Yeah.
And there was a period there, I guess it was the late 80s, where Michael Caine was in everything. And that was kind of disturbing. It was like two movies a year for like 4 years in a row or something.
It's funny. It seems like his whole career kind of has gone this way. He's in 2, 3, 4 movies a year every year since 1965.
But, you know, it was great for a long time until all of a sudden it was like, okay, well, whatever movie you see, you're going to see Michael Caine in it. You know what I mean? And anyway, it kind of, that's how it felt to me. And it's nice that he's taking a break, and I'm looking forward to seeing this new movie where, you know, he's had a little break. And I agree, it would be great to see Sean Connery and Michael Caine together again.
Oh, I'd love to see that.
We better write the script, guys.
Yeah,
boy,
well.
We better get cracking.
All right. good to see the two of you back, the original guys, on the show, doing the show.
Oh, thanks, Richard.
Thanks, right, Richard.
Bye. Thanks for calling. Good evening. You're on take two. Hello.
Hi. You didn't mention one that I love that has a great cast. This is Christy from Oceano.
Hey, Christy.
Hey. Honeymoon Suite
Or is it California Suite?
California Suite.
1978. It's a Neil Simon.
Did someone bring that up already?
No.
Oh, great movie.
Thank you for bringing it up.
Yeah, great movie, great cast.
Gosh, was it Jane Fonda?
Jane Fonda's in it, and Alan Alda. Alan Alda, and God, a bunch of people are in it.
Maggie Smith.
And, what is his name? Bill Cosby's in it, Richard Pryor's in it.
Oh, wow.
They go there together as doctors. And he plays opposite the actress, Dame, not Judy Dench, but...
Maggie Smith.
And yeah. he is fantastic in it.
Gosh, I have not seen that film in decades. I think it came out around 1976 or so.
78.
Classic.
Gosh.
Absolute classic. The whole cast is superb.
Thanks for bringing that one up. That's a great one.
No
Big
problem.
Thumbs up for California Suite.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Thanks for calling.
You. Bye.
Good evening. You're on take two. Hello.
Hello. This is Doris Linden in Arroyo Grande.
Hi, Doris.
And I've talked to you before. I had an interesting comment. We used to live in Malibu for many years, and down on the street from us on Pacific Coast Highway, our good neighbors and very good friends was Joe and Carolyn Sargent. And he's a TV director and did the movie, The Mandela Story in Africa. I think it was called One Man, One Vote, with Sidney Poitier and also Sir Michael Caine.
Wow.
And we got a chance to go up there and visit with them for the full month of May. So we got to meet him, and we actually got to see him work on the set. And it was really a wonderful experience. We remember, how comfortable he was always and how natural when he was filming and, the cameras were rolling.
I'm looking for it on the list here. About what year was this?
It was called One Man, One Vote, and it was a movie for television. Mm-hmm. It was a story on Mandela.
Ah, here it is.
At the time, we used to call it the Mandela Story because they didn't really have a name for it, and then I think after that they called it One Man, One Vote.
Hmm. We might know it as Mandela and de Klerk. Did he play F.W. de Klerk?
Yes, he did.
Okay,
yes,
the South African premiere.
Yes. And it was wonderful. They had one evening. They had a big dinner for the whole cast, and which we got to sit with them and listen to them talk. I think we sat till 2 o'clock in the morning and listened to Sidney Poitier, and it was really wonderful experience.
Wow.
But
wow.
it was nice to meet him and actually watch him working on the set.
Boy, fabulous!
Yeah.
Well, thank you for the call.
Thanks for sharing that with us. We enjoy your show very much.
Well, thanks for being a part of it.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Well, I think we have time for one more call. Good evening. You're on take two. Hi.
Hi. Good evening. This is Lisa from Arroyo Grande.
Hi, Lisa.
Hi. I'm calling to say great show, and I have always loved Michael Caine. Always.
Just like us.
Yeah, and Little Voice. When he has that breakdown on the stage.
Yeah.
Little Voice.
Oh, is Ray.
Yes, Ray.
Yeah, Ray. That's probably one of my favorite of his later roles. What a great little film that was.
Mm-hmm.
He's just fantastic, and he's such a cad. He's horrible.
Well, no one can play a bounder, I think, as well as Michael Caine. I think from the time of Alfie back in 1966 to Ray is a nice send-up on the bounder. From Little Voice. I mean, Caine is, he's the template for the British bounder and cad.
Well, thank you very much. Have a good night.
Oh, thanks for the call. Well, Bob, I think we struck some gold here. Of course, when you look at a career like Michael Caine's, it's so lengthy. It's there's so much. And just like you said, we can get all these great phone calls. Thanks for the great calls of bringing up many of these Michael Caine films that are near and dear to your heart and our hearts. And it's just great to have a guy like Michael Caine working and still working. His new film is called The Quiet American, and I highly recommend it.
This has been a great show. It's almost like we could have done another show on Michael Caine. Just keep going. Caine the Bad Years, of which we could have gone way into detail. But I want to thank all our callers tonight. You were wonderful. And anytime we talk about Michael Caine, it's a winner. And tonight, we had a gas.
Bob, have a great week, and we'll be back again next week here on Public Radio KCBX, San Luis Obispo and Santa Barbara Counties. Take two, the movie program. Thanks to Hank for manning the projector, and we'll see you next week.